I'd like to take a few minutes to talk about functional assessments and how they could be useful measurements of vestibular performance during head movements. So for example, how well can the patient read or focus while they're walking or while they're driving a car, or does the patient get dizzy when they roll over in bed or turn their head in a certain direction? There are a lot of different types of functional tests, but the ones that I want to focus on today are tests that can be done using your current VNG equipment. And specifically, I want to talk about the lateral head roll test and the dynamic visual acuity test. So first, let's talk about a really common abnormality, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, or BPPV, and specifically a variant where the problem is in the horizontal canal. So the patient gets really dizzy when they move their head back and forth as if they're, they're looking over their left or right shoulders. So this would make driving a car nearly impossible, right? This variant of BPPV is often a result from improper maneuvers to correct the simpler posterior canal BPPV. And during that maneuver, the troublesome crystals get moved from the posterior canal to the horizontal canal, and this can produce an even more problematic situation for the patient. So it's really important to have these head models that guide us into the proper head positions during the maneuvers and to have really accurate eye tracking algorithms to assure that we get the correct diagnosis. Dr. Bonner talked earlier about posterior canal BPPV, so I want to quickly show you a case of horizontal canal BPPV. So in this video, what we'll see is the patient turns their head to the right, so they're laying supine, and when they turn their head to the right, that bar was orange and it turns green. So that green is the indicator that lets us know that we're in the correct direction, right? And so as far or as long as the patient has their head turned to the right, we see this right beating horizontal nystagmus, right? And then in a moment, they're going to turn their head to the left. We're going to see the same thing happen. The bar is going to go from orange to green when they turn to the left. And then after a few seconds, we're going to see the nystagmus is going to change directions. So now watch just about here. Now we see the nystagmus starting to beat to the left. So when the patient has their head to the right, they have right beating nystagmus. When they have their head to the left, they have left beating nystagmus. This is geotropic nystagmus. It lets me know that those crystals are in that horizontal canal. And then in just a second, when this test stops, you're going to see a bar graph pop up. And that bar graph is our quick glance that lets us know which side is affected. So you'll see that the right, when the head is rolled to the right, right beating nystagmus of 6. 6 is the cutoff for normal. So that bar graph is white. So that side is the smaller side, or the side with the least amount of nystagmus. When they turn their head to the left, you see 11 degrees of nystagmus. And so that's gray because it's higher than 6. So 7 degrees and higher turns the bar gray. So with one quick glance, we can see that this patient has stronger nystagmus when their head is rolled to the left. So we know that the left lateral canal is the affected canal, right? So a really simple but very accurate tool. But let's take it a little bit further. Let's look just a little bit deeper. So if we actually look now just a little bit closer and we look down here on this second graph where it says vertical left, we can actually see that there's some upbeating nystagmus, right? A few beats of upbeating nystagmus. It may only be 2 degrees and the horizontal nystagmus was only 6. So maybe it doesn't meet our qualifications for abnormal, but it still is a trigger to me that something might be going on. And I think that this patient is having multi-canal involvement. So I think maybe there's posterior and lateral canal involvement. And these variants are very tricky. When there's multiple canals involved, it's very tricky to treat these. And so this would be a perfect case to put into a TRV chair where we can not only precisely maneuver the patient, but we can also provide these little shocks that you'll see in just a second in this video from Mans Magnuson, where we're putting kinetic energy into the system, and that helps those crystals move back to the utricle a little bit more efficiently. So this is a really good treatment for multi-canal variants. See Dr. Magnuson kind of lightly banging the patient's head against those shock absorbers, and that's what forces that kinetic energy into those crystals and helps them move a little bit. So it's important to have an accurate diagnosis. If we can't treat, which we sometimes can't, and sometimes we even make it worse when we try to treat by ourselves, we can always move in to a TRV chair to get a little bit more accurate repositioning. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is what happens when my world has gone blurry, right? So if I have a VOR impairment, so vestibular ocular reflex impairment, then I cannot keep the target or the piece of paper or whatever it is, the stop sign on the street. I can't keep any of those things clear. I can't read the words clearly when I'm moving my head. And so can be a very life-threatening situation, right? So we don't want to be crossing the street and we go to look to the right to see if there's cars coming and our world gets blurry and we trip and fall on the street. So it's really important that the VOR be intact and that we be able to clearly see when we're moving our head. And the way that we can test this is by using dynamic visual acuity. This is an old school method that I'm showing you here with a Snellen eye chart posted on the wall. This is the old way of doing the bedside testing before we had computerized versions of dynamic visual acuity. And you can see in this video, compliments of Dr. Sharon Cushing for Toronto Sick Kids, that she's testing a very young child. So an advantage is you can test people of all ages, right? And here she's having him read the eye chart and just read to the lowest line that he can read. And then she starts shaking his head vigorously. And then he's asked to read again. And if he scores, you know, two lines higher, the letters have to get bigger by two lines before he can see clearly, then we know that he has an impairment in his VOR system. Some drawbacks with this are that it's hard to control that speed, right? There's no feedback to let you know if you're going faster or slower. You can't separate right and head left movements, so you don't really know if it's the right side or the left side that's impaired, and it's not very objective, right? So there's some drawbacks. If you don't have any other tools, it's great. You can do this bedside, but it's much more accurate if we can get this done with a computerized system. So in the computerized system of dynamic visual acuity, you can see that the patient is wearing a headband, and attached to that headband is a little sensor. And then the software is kicking out a sound with a metronome, dunk, 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 dunk. And you'll see that in the next slide. And the patient is instructed to move their head to that beat, and then the clinician is there to help guide them. So a super accurate way to do the test. And you can see here in this video that the clinician is instructing the patient to move their head. And here they're just using a little laptop screen. So if you're limited in space, you can do this with your laptop. And you can see when the patient gets their head into that sweet spot, the right movement, there's a little optotype popping up on the screen. And then the patient is instructed to tell us which way that optotype is pointing, right? And then here you can see that it can also be done and should be done in the vertical planes. In this example, I'm using a larger TV screen. So if you have a larger room, then you can use a larger TV screen. The patient can be further away from the target. Here you can see in this diagram here, in this picture here, that the patient is holding on to the remote control. And so they're instructed to press either a left, right, up, or down. So they'll press the button on that remote control that indicates or tells us which way they think that the optotype is pointing. And then in the software here, you'll be able to hear that metronome. So in the beginning, the head is static, so there's no sound because they're not moving their head. And they're just pressing the button for us to tell us again which direction it was, the optotype was pointing, and then you see this black dot here. This black dot tells me what the patient's static acuity is, and then we start the dynamic testing. You'll hear the sound. So the patient is instructed to move their head to that speed or that sound. When they get into the correct head movement, that little bar, that guide bar, turns green. When the guide bar is green, that's when the optotype pops up. And then the patient, again, responds to the optotype for us with the remote. And at the end of the test, what we see are those open circles, which are the dynamic acuity scores compared to the black closed circle or darkened circle, which was the static score. And so we compare their static scores to their dynamic scores. And if the dynamic scores are much higher, much worse than where the static scores, then we know that they have difficulty with their VOR, difficulty with keeping vision clear for themselves while they're in motion, right? So here's a really nice example. So this is a patient of mine that on day one came in, very dizzy when moving his head. Do the dynamic visual acuity test, and you can see that when he moves his head to the left, the left moving targets, he has a value of 0.6. So the higher up the number goes, the further it gets into that gray area, and that gray area is normative data that we've generated in my clinic. And you can see that he's got poor scores when he moves his head to the left, a little bit better to the right, but still abnormal, and then even some problems up and down, right? Then we send him away doing gaze stabilization exercises and the such for a week and a half, and then he comes back. We test him again, and you can see that his scores are improving, but not all the way better yet. And so then we send him off again, more exercises to do at home, gaze stabilization. He comes back after 3 weeks. He's completely back to normal. So a really nice test, a dynamic visual acuity, is a really nice test that we can use to measure a vestibular compensation over time. And I just want to wrap up with a little video from Dr. Julie Honecker from Cleveland Clinic, and she's just explaining to us how dynamic visual acuity is an advantage to her and her clinic.
Hi, everyone. I'm Julie Honecker here at the Cleveland Clinic. I'm the director of our vestibular imbalance disorders program. I'm here just to talk a little bit about dynamic visual acuity testing. And this is a particular test that I really try to utilize as part of my evaluations. It's great for times where I have patients with suspected bilateral vestibular loss or patients with unilateral involvement, and I want to look at the status of compensation. It's also just great to give a good idea of the functional status of the vestibular ocular reflex. So I encourage you all to use it as well. Thanks so much.